to tell you that the wonderful staff that we have here lives for people like you who care enough to come out and walk these places and understand these places. So you play a tremendous part in the joy that we take in our jobs here in the with the National Park Service. So thank you all very much for that. My name is John Hennessy. I'm the chief historian at the park. Around you tonight is much of the staff that has put this event on in the last couple of days and will continue to do so for the next pretty much 2 weeks we've got to go. So if you see them, some of them aren't terribly visible, but they work even much harder than we do. We stand in front of the public and there's a whole body of people behind us working very hard on your behalf. 150 years ago this very minute, the Army of the Potomac was sprawling across these fields. They had marched south from Culpeper County that day, crossing the river both at Germanna Ford and farther down at Ailey's Ford, passing through Chancellorsville, coming straight down Route 3 toward us from Germanna Ford as well. And late in the day, they reached Wilderness Tavern. Across the valley from us, if we'd been sitting here on that night, we would have been able to see Wilderness Tavern quite easily. And for these men, although they did not know it, this was the eve of battle. It was the beginning of a campaign that the nation, and when I say nation, I mean both Union and Confederacy, looked at with probably as much wary anticipation as any of the war. The nation, the world knew or had a sense of the nature of what was going to happen here. Now, the men who went to sleep in these fields and around this house on that night 150 years ago understood the nature of this war very, very well. In fact, the nature of this war to these men, many of whom had been in the Army for 3 years by now, had become painfully clear to them. One soldier wrote home in a letter before marching here that night. He said, "Hark! I hear the muffled drums and fifes wailing, that mournful, mournful, tremulous dead march. A fellow died in camp last night, only a private, so nobody cares. But the proper form of burial must be gone through, according to regulations. Four drums, four fifes, four men bearing a hospital stretcher and a corpse wrapped in a gray blanket. Eight soldiers with arms reversed, a corporal and then a lieutenant and a chaplain in a long rubber coat. In a few minutes, that gray blanket and its enfolded corpse will be resting in a muddy hole. And tomorrow, everybody will have forgotten the man that was buried. But perhaps, in some far-off, humble household, anxious days and sleepless nights will be spent watching for the wanderer who will never return. How little, very little, we think of the grief produced by war's calamities." And then he went on in a remarkable passage. "For every man who falls in battle, someone mourns. For every man who lies in hospital wards and of whom no notice taken, someone mourns. For the humblest soldier shot on picket and of whose humble exit from the stage of life is little thought, someone mourns. Nor is this alone. For every soldier disabled, for everyone who loses an arm or a leg, or who is wounded, or who languishes in protracted suffering, some heart bleeds, some tears are shed, bitter tears, of which the world never knows." By 1864, the tendrils of grief and suffering touched almost every corner of America. And almost every man who gathered around this house to sleep that night knew precisely the grief and the pain that this war entailed. Long gone were the days of 1861 and 62 when a youthful, sometimes happy ignorance propelled these soldiers, a belief that war might be something different than what they feared it would be. But now, these men understood. The war seems to be now one great job, said one soldier. A steady, regular job, and a business reduced to science. So you might think that the explosion of war's mythology might somehow diminish the soldier's commitment to carry on. In fact, just the opposite happened. The investment of life in toil, in body, in effort, in time, and treasure just deepened each side's commitment to victory. And that, if you want to understand the 1864 Overland Campaign, is something you must remember. The armies that came here had 3 years to ponder this war. Its nature, its meaning, and all its hardships. These soldiers understood, as well as any soldiers who ever fought under the American flag, why they were fighting and what was at stake. Union and Confederate understood. So as these men settled down in this yard and in these fields and across the way up by Wilderness Tavern that night, there were not a lot of reflections, romantic, about the sturdy vault above them. In fact, or rather, there was a lot of deep reflection about what lay ahead. Be they Union or Confederates, and the Confederates this night were about 5 or 6 miles down the road, west of us here, they sensed that what they were about to experience would exceed anything that had been asked of them to this point. And still, they came. One soldier wrote, "The summer days are almost here, when we shall be warily plodding over the roads once more in search of victory or death. Many a poor fellow will find the latter, and it may be a solace to him. I dread the approaching campaign. I can see horrors insurmountable throughout the summer months. Unlike some of the wars of our lifetimes, there was no misunderstanding or confusion about what the nations, what this war was intended to accomplish. Instead, the question in 1864 was a matter of will. Would each side, would each army, would each nation or aspiring nation be able to put in the effort, suffer the pain to achieve what they hope to achieve? Of course, nations, not armies, answer that question. But the armies are the people's proxy. And make no mistake, what happened out here was more than a clash of armies. It was a clash of nations and ideas. And everyone, Union and Confederate, understood what was at stake out here. And so tonight I'd like to spend a little bit of time talking about these proxy armies, as I've just called them, and what this war meant, how it had changed, and what the experience they were about to embark on meant to this nation. The Army of the Potomac, we're going to talk about both armies. The Army of the Potomac, the Union Army, commanded by George Gordon Meade, accompanied by Ulysses S. Grant, into the wilderness on May 4th, 1864, had in prior years sometimes been poorly led. It had been misused, it had been beaten, it had been criticized. It had been battered not just by Lee, but by the Northern press, Congress, even the president at one point somewhat derisively called the army McClellan's bodyguard. It, or parts of that army, had fought under a number of commanders, Pope, McClellan, Burnside, Hooker, and now Meade. I mean, think of an organization you've been in that has had five different managers in the span of a year. It's very difficult for any organization to thrive under a circumstance like that. The instability at the top of this army did the army, of course, no good, except in one way. And that was this army, the Army of the Potomac, found its identity, unlike the Army of Northern Virginia, which was just fully identified with its commander. The Army of the Potomac found its identity with itself. It would show no great enthusiasm for any commander after McClellan in 1862. But over time, it showed more and more enthusiasm for itself. So what happens to an organization when it's criticized, when it's abused from the outside, when that organization knows it's right? What happens to it? The whole organization very often coalesces, develops something of a siege mentality. If you want people to coalesce, put them under siege. They usually do under those circumstances. Everyone blows about this army, one soldier wrote. If the Army of the Potomac would only do so-and-so, then everything will go all right, they say. True, yes, true. We have not been victorious, but the fault is not with the troops, for never have men been known to fight as this army has fought, even when we knew we were going to be outgeneraled and defeated. Any man will fight when flushed with former victories, but it is only this shattered army that will face the enemy, though defeat be certain. The victory at the Battle of Gettysburg, the first unambiguous victory of the war on a large scale for the Army of the Potomac, steeled its identity, gave it confidence. You want to know why all the monuments and Civil War parks are at Gettysburg? That's why. You want to know why Gettysburg is the most important battlefield in the nation and viewed by most people to be the most important of the Civil War? Because the soldiers who fought there, who would run the nation, thought it was. And to them, it was. Now, we can argue about its place in the history of the Civil War, but you can hardly argue about its place in the evolution of American culture and this history of this army. One other thing shaped the story of the Army of the Potomac. It was Washington's army. It was the army that fought near Washington. I mentioned on my tour this morning, if you work in the federal government, one of the realities of life is the closer you are to Washington, the closer you're watched, the more people see. If you work at Manassas, heck, half the leaders of the nation drive by Manassas battlefield every day. And so it gets more attention. And this army, close to Washington, close to the media centers, got a lot of attention. In fact, the United States Congress created a committee dominantly to oversee and question this army. And so this army had a great deal of wind blowing against it, and it shielded itself from that wind. But another outcome of that, we see these soldiers oftentimes as kind of automatons, unthinking. We sometimes see all soldiers that way. But in fact, this army was probably more politically aware than any army in American history, because it was the object of political debate. And it engaged in the great debates of the war. You all know, of course, that in 1862, this army was completely devoted to George Britton McClellan. You also know probably that in 1864, George Britton McClellan ran for president. But maybe what you don't know is that in 1864, in the election of 1864, the first election in American history where soldiers were permitted to vote, this army voted to the tune of about 76% for Abraham Lincoln. They voted not the person, but the cause. And the cause that they had so much invested in and the cause that they would pay so much, the greatest of all prices, the highest price of all, for the continuance in this war, will be paid by the army that voted for him. You may be assured that this Army of the Potomac will not fail of doing its best, one soldier wrote about a week before this battle. Our success in the field will be of little avail, though, if it is not supported by Union victories at home. When we see men who preach treason in the House of Representatives, and by that he means preaching for peace and negotiated peace with the Confederacy, when we see that they only receive a censure, it is a wonder if we grow despondent and ask whether it is worthwhile to make the sacrifice we are making. But thanks to our friends who can vote as well as fight, and while we are whipping the secessionists in the South, we can also aid in defeating their more culpable brethren in the North. The North was deeply divided over this war. America's often divided over war, and this is not an exception. But the Army clearly had a position on its view of the war. One soldier wrote, "Old Abe will stand a poor sight in November if he don't finish the work here in Virginia." So even the lowest privates understood what was at stake here. The Union's victory in this war, it was clear by the spring and summer of 1862, depended not only on the success of the Army, but the election or the re-election of Abraham Lincoln. Democrats had pledged a platform that would bring this war to an end by negotiation if they were elected. Lincoln, of course, had pledged to carry the war to a conclusion, to put down the rebellion, and to restore the Union entirely. If you want to understand what was different about what happened here, why there was such a sense of urgency and a sense of that what happened here would be decisive, the answer is in the looming election. Because if these armies were not successful and Lincoln were not reelected, most in the armies recognized that this war would end differently than they wished that it would. And so there was a sense of urgency as the armies took to the field this summer. So here's a question for you. May of 1864, and the great issue that had divided this nation and divided the Union war effort was the question of emancipation. Was it appropriate for this army to be used as an agent of emancipation? The soldiers who gathered around this house and in these fields on the night of May 4th, 1864, did they fight to end slavery? Did they? Some of them? It's an interesting question, and one we often confuse the answer on. The attitudes of slavery, the approach of the armies and the nation within this war towards slavery was perhaps the most important question that divided the North in 1862 and 63. Into the late 1863, which is why I bring it up today. It's a vital question. And early in the war, the Army was definitely opposed to its use, by and large, not all men in the Army, but by and large, opposed to its use as an agent for emancipation. Resisted it, argued against it. But something happened as the war went on. And after Abraham Lincoln issued the Emancipation Proclamation on January 1st, 1863, very slowly you see the soldiers in this army, even the ardent racists in the army, and mind you, when we talk about race and slavery, you have to make a distinction between the two. Someone's racial attitudes are not the same as necessarily their attitudes on slavery. Heck, Lincoln and Davis had very similar attitudes about race in many ways, but they had completely different attitudes about slavery and its place in American society. But over time, the soldiers in this army largely, not entirely, but largely came to see that the end of slavery had value for them. As one soldier wrote, there was a great change in the army with respect to slavery. Its overthrow was a military necessity. We destroy tanneries, flour mills, and other fixtures. Why not then weaken and destroy the strong arm of slavery, which has been used to raise food for the Army of the Confederates, or dig rifle pits, or throw up earthworks? And so there was a practical value. These men weren't necessarily moralistic. They weren't ardent abolitionists, but they were practical men. And as they gathered around this house that night, most of them recognized that slavery must end. And they also recognized that as a matter of policy, no matter their motivation, they marched to end slavery because it was the government's policy. It might not have been their motivation, but it was the government's policy to end slavery. And of course, armies fight to achieve the ends the government sets for them. But the biggest change to this army, of course, was the arrival of Ulysses S. Grant. An immense change it was. This conservative organization, with a culture of management that had discouraged initiative, that had in fact punished initiative when it was not successful. And this army had evolved into an organization that had a culture that was anything but what Ulysses S. Grant wanted it to be. And the great challenge for Grant, when he arrived in Virginia, was to change the culture of the Army of the Potomac and to encourage aggression, encourage initiative, which is why here, tomorrow morning on May 5th, 150 years ago, as the morning progresses minute by minute by minute, you can see Grant beginning to assert himself, insisting that the Yankees move faster, faster, harder, harder. And the Army, of course, at first is sluggish. Over time does better. But Grant's presence here was an immense factor in the evolution, the life of the Army of the Potomac. He's a concentration of all that is American, wrote one man. He talks bad grammar, but he talks it naturally, as much as to say, I was brought up, and if I try fine phrases, I shall only appear silly. One man said of him, General Grant is a short, thick-set man and rode his horse like a bag of meal, he said. I was a little disappointed in his appearance. He was probably the most famous military man in America other than Robert E. Lee at that time, and there was great curiosity about him, and there are literally thousands of descriptions of Grant. One man described him as stumpy, unmilitary, slouchy, and Western-looking. Very ordinary, in fact. I don't know what Western-looking is, but I guess it's slouchy and stumpy, according at least to that man. But as one soldier wrote, Lincoln's political fortunes, not less than the great cause of the country, are in the hands of General Grant, and the failure of the general will be the overthrow of the government. And Grant, of course, was acutely aware of this, but not consciously or not obviously aware of it. He didn't talk about it. He did write a brief letter to his wife. He said, before you receive this, I will be away from Culpeper and the army will be in motion. I know the greatest anxiety is now felt in the North for success of this move, and that the anxiety will increase when it is once known that the army is in motion. I feel well myself, he said. I believe it has never been my misfortune to be placed where I lost my presence of mind, unless, indeed, it has been when thrown in strange company, particularly of ladies. Under such circumstances, I know I must appear a fool, he said. But remember that George McClellan was the master of reasons not to do things. His first thought was, what is the other guy going to do to me? Grant's first thought, like Lee's, was, what am I going to do to the other guy? And trying to get this army to think like that was Grant's goal. I would argue that he really never succeeded entirely. He improved it, but he was never able to really transform the army from what it had been, and the subordinate commanders within it from what it had been to what he wanted it to be. I dread the spring, is one soldier concluded a letter written just before this campaign opened. On the night of May 3rd, 1864, many soldiers in the Army were called out for dress parade before sunset. The Army would march after midnight that night because the Confederates could clearly see the Union camps in Culpeper County. And so Grant and Meade ordered that the Army would not move until after the sun came down. There would be no evidence given to the Confederates that the Army was about to move until the sun went down. One soldier remembered being called out for parade that night. Up and down the immense camp, we could see regiment after regiment, battery after battery fall into line. Then there was silence most profound. We listened attentively to the orders to march, to the right, to the left, in the distance before us and far behind us. Suddenly, cheers arose. Battery after battery, regiment after regiment, cheered until men were hoarse. My comrades, this was a new soldier to the Army. This would be his first battle in the Army. My comrades did not cheer. They seemed to be profoundly impressed, but not the least bit elated. The wonted silence of the evening was repeatedly broken by the resounding shouts of distant troops who could not contain their joy that the season of inactivity was over and the campaign, which we all hoped would be short and decisive, was open. And so they would come. And so they would march up this road, onto these grounds, crawl around the house, down around the cemetery down here, and that night, the Army would go to sleep. Down the road, 6 miles, the Army of Northern Virginia was stirring. The Army of Northern Virginia had heard a great deal about Ulysses S. Grant, too. And they could tick off the press claims about his virtues just as well as a Yankee could. But in any commentary on Grant by men in the Army of Northern Virginia inevitably ended with this: he has not yet met Robert E. Lee. In fact, there were some in the Union Army who said the same thing. The Army of Northern Virginia had as much confidence in its leader as any army on earth has ever had in its leader in 1864. We were anxious for the campaign to begin, wrote one officer. We wanted to see Grant introduced to General Lee in the Army of Northern Virginia, for we knew that we simply could not be driven off a battlefield, and whatever force Grant brought, his luck would have to accommodate itself to that fact. Now, it's likely that certainly during the Civil War, I don't think any organization was more thoroughly identified with its leader than was the Army of Northern Virginia with Robert E. Lee. For the great masses of the South, Lee was the great hope. Remember, across the South elsewhere, the Confederacy had met a steady, rolling tide of defeat and even disasters in places. But not in Virginia. Lee was the great hope. Now, was he going to turn the tide of war to the point where the South would conquer the North? Of course not. That was not his purpose. What was his purpose? His purpose was to affect the North's will and ability to continue this war, to create enough disaffection in the North that with their balance, the American people would decide, enough. We must find another way. It's not an implausible outcome, even now as we look back at it. Lincoln thought it the most likely outcome in May of 1864. Now, Robert E. Lee is often accused of not being a very politically aware man, and I would argue just the opposite. He was entirely aware. He was much adored, as I've mentioned. I'll read a couple of quotes. One man said of him, he sat behind him in church in Orange during the winter of 1863-64, and he was so excited. He sat one row behind Lee, and Jefferson Davis was sitting next to him. And he described them in great details. And one of the great lost skills in America or in the world today is the skill of personal description. Nobody describes anybody anymore. But these men described each other all the time. And this man was so excited to sit behind Heinle, he even described the hair growing out of his ears, for God's sakes. Now, it's interesting, I wrote a blog post about this because it's really a remarkable passage. And someone got mad and suggested that I was trying to somehow defame Lee by suggesting he had hair growing out of his ears. I think we all do on one level. But in fact, by describing Lee in such detail, this man was clearly paying Lee this immense compliment. And then he closed his letter in which he described Lee. And he said that, if I can find it here, it is, hang on a second, oh. We all feel better at the sight of our grand chieftain. No one can excite their enthusiasm as he does, and no wonder, for such a noble face he has, and such noble deeds as he has performed, deserve an admiration. And you'd be hard-pressed to find a lot of people in the South who didn't agree with that. In fact, you'd be hard-pressed to find a lot of people in the North who didn't agree, as much as they wished to see Lee meet his demise. Now, Lee is a very interesting man, and we talked about Grant as a manager and McClellan as a manager. What was Lee like as a manager? I often say we've all worked with a George McClellan. In fact, some of us have George McClellan-type personalities as children, finding reasons not to do things. My daughter's an expert at that. Not to say that McClellan was childish at all, but we work with these people. But I have a hard time in my own life's experience envisioning someone like Lee that I've encountered. He's still very worth understanding. If you want to be successful, he does many of the things that are essential to success in your world today, even. He was very politically aware. He was very intent on getting along with his boss. One of the watchwords of a successful professional life is to get along with your boss. And he was assiduous about getting along with Jefferson Davis, or at least giving the appearance of informing him. Even after the decision had been made, he would sometimes send Davis a note saying, "I'm thinking about doing this, what do you think?" When in fact it was already done. But Davis over time developed great trust in Lee, and it was a tremendous union. He was, as I mentioned, very politically aware. He said, "We should reject no honorable means of dividing and weakening our enemies, so that they may sometimes feel the difficulties we have experienced. It seems to me that the most effective way to accomplish this object is to give all the encouragement we can to the rising peace party in the North." So Lee is completely aware of the divisions and schisms in the Union war effort, and they guide his every effort from the moment he takes command in June of 1862 until all hope is lost in the days before Appomattox. When Lee made a decision, he made a commitment. And when he decided, even if the decision was not the best, he would follow through with it decisively. There was no wavering once a decision was made. Lee was very little affected by criticism, another great and necessary characteristic of a leader, a manager. He once wrote about it, he joked about it, he said, "We made a great mistake in the beginning of our struggle. We appointed all our worst generals to command our armies and all our best generals to edit our newspapers," he said. Lee always focused on what he might do to the other guy. He spent very little energy worrying about what the other guy was going to do to him. And so, the initiative was incredibly important to Lee, but by 1864, he had not the tools to do what he had done before, and so he had to improvise. One of his great characteristics as a manager, when the opportunity was available to him, was assigning the right person to the right job. Case in point, Thomas Jonathan Jackson, his great subordinate, who in many ways was not uniformly great or masterful, but Lee recognized the ways in which he was. Jackson was the man who created opportunity out of nothing. He was like the point guard on a basketball team. Fast, mayhem, creating opportunities when nothing else existed. He was not necessarily great down in the low post, banging around in a slugfest, but with space and time, Jackson was a master, and Lee recognized that. And after Jackson's death, Lee could never find those functions. He had competent men serving under him, including Longstreet, but Longstreet was no point guard. Longstreet was a wing guard, small forward, who might wait off on the wing for the opportunity and then respond. Different animals. And Lee never asked Longstreet to do really what Jackson had done. Longstreet responded to situations. Jackson created situations. And for a man intent on seizing and holding the initiative as the lifeblood of hope for a nation, Lee no longer had a ready source for that to happen. Not only that, he had a man as an opponent now who was equally determined to do precisely the same things. Lee's men, devoted to him, to their cause, without question. One of the things that I've noted over the years, especially looking at civilian correspondence and letters and diaries, while there was discouragement and there was suffering in the South and in Spotsylvania County, there was not a lot of yielding of the determination to emerge with a new nation among these people. And certainly Lee's men were the last men in the Confederacy who might be doing that. One of the great sources of hope for the soldiers in the ranks in the Confederate Army who had marched down this highway, Route 20, the Orange Turnpike, on the morning of May 5th and confront Lee's army for the first time at Saunders Field about 1 o'clock that afternoon. Many of them were very much aware that their great hope was the wobbling in the Union War. And if they could win a victory, if they could deny Grant what he wished to accomplish, they knew or hoped that that war effort would collapse. And these men knew that. They were not simply focused on the military act at hand. They knew that their military act had a political outcome that was vital, as they saw it, to their new nation and the families and communities from which they came. Inflamed by the frenzy of despair at the prospect of their fast-falling cause, and knowing that they must do something to quiet discontent at home, they will doubtless spare nothing to be successful in the coming campaign, wrote one Virginian. But we are elated at the prospect of a speedy deliverance from Yankee rule and tyranny. Our army is in fine condition and daily increasing in strength. But of course, it wasn't quite as simple as all that, because Lee struggled to sustain his army in the field. The South steadily was losing the ability, the territory, the resources needed to sustain armies in the field. Rations had been reduced, and when they hadn't been reduced in the army, it was because the food available to civilians had to been reduced. And across the South, at every level, every Confederate, civilian and soldier, struggled in some way to sustain this cause in 1864. And so, confident, woven to its commander unlike any other, undersized, about half the size of the Union Army, the Army of Northern Virginia was, slightly underfed, the Army of Northern Virginia prepared for this campaign. And so, on May 4th and May 5th, 1864, the armies would come to this place. One chaplain wrote home to his hometown newspaper before the campaign. One word in closing. Pray for us. We trust that we may be at the dawn of better things. The Army must not be forgotten now. That could have been written by a Northern or a Southerner with equal applicability. And then, of course, as these men stood on the verge of a campaign that they knew would ask more of them than had ever been asked, both in terms of the physical effort, but also in terms of their lives, they reflected on that, and they reflected on it constantly. One man said, "We all expect when we go into a fight to be killed or wounded. Fear does not really exist in this army. Men march into battle, sometimes singing, whistling, laughing, and joking, the same as if they were on their way home. Comrade is killed no matter what the living ones say. Poor Bill, or whatever his name is, has gone, or in army slang, his chunk is put out. Thus it is lit alive one moment, and gone to the soldier's grave and final account the next. So far as I am concerned, I feel that my life is in God's hands. If it is his will that I shall come out of the battle unharmed, it will be so. If I am to fall, it is his pleasure, and what he doeth well." And thousands of soldiers had attitudes similar to that, placing faith in God, throwing up their hands, and allowing fate to take its part. All seemed to dread the approaching struggle, wrote one Confederate, though they feel hopeful of success. "We all feel that though Grant may be driven back beyond the Rapidan, our lives may be lost in the struggle. Such feelings, of course, make us wish the day to be deferred as long as possible. I should hate very much to fall now after so many battles have been fought, but perhaps it may be as well now as any time. We cannot live over 40 or 50 years more anyway, and we would probably hate to die as much then as now." And so they came. A Union staff officer stood on a distant hill looking toward where we're sitting today and described the scene 150 years ago this evening. "I was standing on the north side of the pike at the top of the ridge about 300 yards east of Wilderness Run. I overlooked the Lacey Estate." This, of course, is the Lacey Estate. "And had you stood in its lonely dooryard as the sun was going down," this is the dooryard of the tavern he's talking about, so he's looking this way, "as the sun was going down, as it is tonight, on May 4th, and the shadows of the woods were reaching into the fields, the men of Crawford's and Wadsworth's divisions all preparing their evening meals, the smoke of their little fires lifting softly over them, would have been in full view below you." And that was the scene here on that night. Not only was that soldier looking here, but metaphorically at least, the whole world was. This was by far the most important thing happening in the world in May of 1864. And everybody here knew it. I give a quote from a New Jersey newspaper in an editorial on May 3rd, 1864. "The Impending Tempest," they titled it. "The quiet that prevails in our armies is justly felt to be the hush which foreruns the tempest. The war will soon be poured out with unprecedented violence. The magnitude of the events which are now being shaped has produced a feeling of deep solemnity in all thoughtful minds. And even the giddy and thoughtless are rendered comparatively sober and sedate. None are so dull in feeling as to be unaffected by the tremendous issues which are at stake and the terrific tragedy that is about to be enacted." This is the eve of battle. Thank you very much. Any questions?
How many men did Grant have?
Grant had, in total, well, mind you, it was Meade's army, at least most of it was, Grant had, but under the whole umbrella, about 120,000 men. Lee had a bit over 60,000 men out here. Now, Lee was not unaccustomed to odds like that. He had fought with worse odds than that at Chancellorsville, for sure. Yes?
How many of Grant's men were living in Culpeper in that
case? How many of Grant's men were in Culpeper County that winter? About 90 or 100,000 of them were in Culpeper County. The town's population was about 12, or excuse me, the community's population was actually about 16,000. So counting it all up, there were about 10 soldiers for every resident who had been there. It was one of the biggest cities, as Frank pointed out, one of the biggest cities in America for the 5 months that the Union Army was there. The Confederate Army, of course, was largely in Orange County over here, not as large, but their camp still survived. If we had had an extra day, we would have done a tour of the Confederate camps, like the one we did of the Union camps this morning. But Montpelier, if you ever get to Montpelier, they have a tremendous preserved Confederate camp from that winter encampment. It's beautifully, beautifully done. So if you ever get a chance to go there. Yes?
Why would Lee's army have been underfed in their own territory?
The question is, why was Lee's army underfed in their own territory? We talked a little bit about this the other day. The greatest impact on these communities, Spotsylvania, Culpeper, Caroline, Stafford, all of these communities, the great impact of the early war was the departure of slaves from this community. Mind you, the slaves outnumbered white residents in Culpeper and in Spotsylvania County. 60% of the residents of Spotsylvania County were enslaved. When those slaves, most of them, probably two-thirds of them, would leave prior to 1863 and run to the Union lines, that essentially removed the ability of this community to sustain itself. Because those slaves had worked the land, had cultivated the crops. In 1864, Spotsylvania County, in which this house resides, sent an appeal to Richmond asking for relief from any levies that the government would apply because there is not enough food in this community to feed itself. So these armies were not living amidst bounty. They were dependent on other areas of the South, and those areas, first off, the South was shrinking functionally. The Confederacy was shrinking as Union armies moved. And then the South had a continually difficult challenge in moving materials and food to supply its army. But you know what? Almost all of Virginia was hungry in 1864, not just Lee's. Yes?
Will you have anything to talk on Todd's Tavern?
The question is, do we have anything planned for Todd's Tavern? We do not have anything specific planned for Todd's Tavern. It's privately owned, and truth be told, we had to kind of, for our own survival's sake, because we're doing something every day for a long time, that was just something we were not able really to endeavor and take on. Well, something that we have done and will do in the future. We're just not having to do it this week.
Oh, thank you. When are you going to write your own book?
When am I going to write my own book? Well, I have to say that I do love to write. But working the last 6 to 8 months or 2 years here with the new exhibits and this, last thing I want to do when I go home at night is write anything. I concluded that writing a book is like, a lot of people say that when you run a marathon, you lose 10% of your IQ, which explains why anybody runs more than one marathon. I think writing a book has the same effect on people, because once you know what's entailed with it, you really have to be a little nutty to really want to do it again. Which eventually I will, but not anytime soon. I hope actually this summer we can actually start having our own thoughts rather than National Park Service thoughts once again, I suspect.
I want to thank you for doing what you do.
Oh, well, thank you very much. Well, I think we're rather fond of the staff that we have here, but I would say that they're really the best at what they do at any of the Civil War parks, with no insult to any of them. And I say that largely because that's what people keep telling me, that they really are a fabulous variety of minds and abilities, but all underlain by just an incredible commitment to these places and the stories that we tell. So thank you very much for that.
May you live many, many, many years.
Yeah, but I don't want to go. I am doing the bicentennial. Sorry. I mean, I might be around, but I'm not doing it. So someone else will be here. Yes? No, the parking tomorrow, and our incident command team will correct me if I'm wrong, but parking for that program is on Hill Yule Drive. All the programs, everything that's not here, if there's direct parking on site.
Direct parking.
Everything in Spotsylvania has direct parking on site. And you may, if there's lots of people, you might have to walk a little distance, but we'll